Hello friends. So in the last class, or last couple of classes actually, we have been looking at multi-component systems, particularly pertaining to ideal gas mixtures and ideal mixtures of real gases. By ideal, we mean that due to mixing, there is no change in any of the extensive properties. So if I mix 1 liter of substance A with 1 liter of substance B, we get 2 liters of a mixture. Likewise, all the extensive properties when they are mixed are just added. So that is what happens in ideal mixtures. But that is not the way a real mixture in the real world behaves. So what happens in the real world is that when I mix substances, then the properties change. The simplest example is that of water and ethanol. So you bring 1 liter of water and 1 liter of ethanol and mix the two together. You expect 2 liters of the mixture, but eventually what you find is that the volume of the mixture is less than 2 liters. So where did the remainder disappear? It's basically because of the kind of intermolecular forces that exist in mixtures between molecules, that the volume that they together occupy is reduced. It could be understood in a rather simplistic way like this, that suppose I have a container with, let's say, pebbles of uniform size, or rather, let's say, marbles of uniform size. Okay, now into this I put another set of grains, let us say grains of sand. So I have 1 liter vessel full of marbles and another 1 liter vessel full of sand, and if I put these two together and thoroughly mix them, just shaking them together, I can expect that the volume of the two together can be less than 2 liters. So this is in a simple way to visualize what happens when dissimilar molecules are put together and mixed in the form of a real mixture. Right? So in reality, whenever we mix substances, the extensive properties change. That is, the volume changes, the internal energy changes, the enthalpy changes, the entropy changes. So it is no more equal to the summation of those properties of the constituents, but it is going to be different from that. And how much it is going to be different from the summation will also depend on the composition. And therefore, the extensive properties there are going to be unique functions of the temperature, pressure, and the composition. So this is basically what you are going to see. And so it's not going to be straightforward to find out the properties of the mixture directly from the properties of the constituents. You need to make measurements at different compositions and then quantify the properties of the mixture, and therefore the change from what happens to that of the original constituents. Right? So this is basically what we need to understand about multi-component systems, and once this is understood, a lot of difficulties about multi-component systems actually go away. Okay, so let's look at the mathematical treatment for the multi-component systems. So for that, let's go to the whiteboard. Right, here we are. So what we will do today is a more generalized formulation, and the ideal mixtures or ideal gas mixtures become a special case of what we are going to do now. Alright, so now suppose X is an extensive property. Okay, say one of volume or internal energy or enthalpy or entropy. Okay. Now, the suppose of a mixture, right? Then, suppose this mixture X, this mixture contains, it is at temperature T and pressure P, and contains N1 moles of species 1, N2 moles of species 2, and so on, N moles of species N. Okay, so this is your mixture that you have. Then this X is going to be a function of temperature, pressure, N1, N2, N3, etc., Nn. Okay, so this is what we know. So since this is an extensive property, suppose I take a factor K and say there are, let's say, at the same temperature and pressure, I put KN1 moles of N over species 1, KN2 moles of species 2, KN3 moles of species 3, and so on, KNN moles of species N, where K is an arbitrary number. Then what happens? I get Kx here, right? Because if I had N1, N2, N3, etc., Nn moles of the mixture, and another, let us say, 2N1, 2N2, 2N3, 2N4, I expect that the volume of that mixture would be twice as the volume of this mixture, because it is the same composition, but only the number of moles is doubled. So this Kx would be this, right? So now, if I differentiate both the sides with respect to K, right, what will I get? I'll get differentiating with respect to K on both sides. I'll get X on the left hand side, and this is equal to del X by del T at del X by del of KN1 into del of KN1 by del N1 plus. So if I, since this K is an arbitrary constant, temperature and pressure differentiated with respect to that would give you 0 partially. So these things will be 0. Only for the N1, N2 you will have these terms. So this will be del X by del KN1 into del KN1 by del N1 plus del X by del KN2 into del KN2 by del K. Okay, so this should be del K, sorry. Plus and so on, del X by del KNN into del KNN by del K. Now, if you look at this, del KN1 by del K would be N1, del KN2 by del K should be N2, and so on. This will be NN. So, what you will get is therefore N1 into del X by del KN1, N2 into del X by del KN2, and so on. So, you will get X is equal to N1 into del X by del KM1 plus N2 times del x divided by del of KN2 plus and so on NN into del x by del of KNN. Right? So this is basically what you get, or this is nothing but summation over I is equal to 1 to N of NI into del x by del of KNI. Right? Now this is the definition of x, and since k is arbitrary and this expression is valid for all values of k, it's also valid for k is equal to 1. So I should be say choose k is equal to 1 to make this expression simple, then I get x is equal to summation of ni into del x by del ni. This is what you get. And if I call this expression, so now this partial derivative basically means that all other variables other than ni are kept constant here, which basically means temperature is kept constant, pressure is kept constant, and all nj not equal to I are kept constant. So you imagine a mixture which is at temperature T and pressure P, and it has the same number of moles of all the other species. I only change one species, species I, by a little bit, and I observe the change in x because of that, then that is what is this quantity that is there in this partial derivative. So that derivative, partial derivative multiplied by ni summed over all n, n is equal to 1 to n, seems to be equal to the extensive property. So if I call this partial derivative as xi bar, which I call as the partial molar x. So this is called the partial molar x of species I. Okay, so this is that. Then this summation can be written as summation over I is equal to 1 to n, not n but I, summation over I is equal to 1 to n of ni xi bar. Okay, so this xi bar is nothing but the partial molar property, which is del x by del ni when all the other properties are kept constant. Now this is the basic definition of partial molar property, and you can see that this has an expression very similar to the ideal mixtures or ideal gases that we had, where any x is equal to summation of ni into xi bar, I is equal to 1 to n, where this xi bar is nothing but the specific x, that is x per unit mole of the pure substance I. Here you get x per unit mole of the substance I as it exists in the mixture. That is the difference. So you can now again go back to the imagination or the analogy that we gave of a mixture of pebbles and sand or marbles and sand. So in the mixture, right, the volume that is occupied by the individual substance as it exists in the mixture is different from the volume that the substance occupied when it was a pure substance. Okay, so the partial molar volume in that particular case, in this particular case, x is imagined to be volume, then for example V for an ideal mixture, so this is ideal if I say, is equal to summation of ni into Vi bar. So if I had n substances 1 to n, each of them had a specific volume, molar specific volume Vi kilomole per cubic meter, then the V of the ideal mixture was the summation of ni into Vi bar. This is n into V. So if I can divide by n, I get V of the mixture, ideal mixture, is equal to summation of xi vi bar. Okay. So this xi is the mole fraction for I is equal to 1 to n. In this particular case, you will get x by n, which I write as x bar, which is the partial molar property x. So this x and this x can be confusing. Actually, this is the general variable, general extensive property x. So this x bar becomes equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n of ni by n would give me xi, xi into capital Xi bar. This is the partial molar property and this is the mole fraction. So this is the thing that you get. So the property that is observed as it exists in the mixture, so for volume if I write, so it will be V bar of the mixture, the real mixture, is equal to summation from I is equal to 1 to n of Xi into Vi bar, and this Vi bar is the volume of the individual species as it is present in the mixture, which is different from the pure substance Vi at the same temperature and pressure. Okay, so this Vi therefore is a function of temperature, pressure as well as composition, whereas this Vi is solely a function of temperature and pressure. Okay, so that is the difference that you have. So this is a property of the pure substance, whereas this is the property of a given substance I as it exists in the mixture at that composition. Right? So that is the difference that you get. So likewise, you can write for various other properties as well. So I'll move from the X notation to the individual things. So for a real mixture, I can write the volume V is equal to summation of ni vi bar. Okay. Similarly, u is equal to summation of ni ui bar. So we'll continue to write it in capital with a bar here. H is equal to summation of ni hi bar, and s is equal to summation of ni si bar. Okay. Or if I want to write it dividing by n, we'll be able to write V of the mixture is equal to summation of xi vi bar. Okay. U of the mixture is nothing but summation of xi ui bar. And H of the mixture is equal to summation of xi hi bar. And S of the mixture is summation of xi si bar. Okay, so this is all summed over I is equal to 1 to n. The total capital N is the number of species. Okay, so this is basically the thing. So if I take the example of a two component mixture, let us say A and B are the two species and we consider a binary mixture. Binary mixture means two component mixture of A and B, then according to this, the V of the mixture would be equal to NA VA bar plus NB VB bar. So this is basically what you try to understand from this. Or in per mole kind, so if you divide throughout by NA plus NB, which is the total number of moles, so So if I write this is equal to n a plus n b into v bar. Okay, so if I divide throughout by n a plus n b, I'll get v bar is equal to x a into v a bar plus x b into v b bar, where x a is the mole fraction n a by n a plus n b, and x b is the mole fraction n b by n b k n a plus n b. Okay, so which will be actually also equal to 1 minus x a. So this is the way you look at it. Similarly, you will get u bar of the mixture will be x a u a bar plus x b into u b bar. Okay, where u a bar and u b bar are the partial molar internal energies of a and b as it exists in the mixture, and that will be defined as, so the u a bar will be defined as del u by del n a, well, when n b temperature and pressure are kept constant. Okay, similarly this will be defined as del u by del n b, where n a temperature and pressure are kept constant. Right, so this is the way you understand it. In the same way, this is volume and so on. So you see that there is a change clearly from the way we wrote it for ideal solution for ideal mixtures. In the ideal solution for ideal mixtures, this was directly the property of the pure substance at that temperature and pressure. Whereas in this case, this is a property of the substance as it exists in the mixture. Okay, so sorry about the confusion. So x I v I bar. Okay, so this v I bar is actually del v by del x I when all the other quantities x j not equal to I and temperature and pressure are kept constant. So T P X J not equal to I. Okay, sorry about that. We should talk page. So that is the kind of definition that you get. So as you approach ideal solution, this V I bar actually becomes equal to V bar. Or in other words, if I look at the change in volume, due to mixing, will actually be volume of the mixture in the real case minus summation of ni vi bar for the same substance. So this is the mixture as it is if it were the sum of the pure substance volumes. So this is basically what is this? This is actually Vi bar, right? This is not Vi bar, so it's actually Vi. It's the volume of the individual species, okay? Which can be volume of the individual species, which can be written as Ni into Vi bar, where this Vi bar, small Vi bar, is the molar specific volume, okay? So this Vi bar is molar specific volume of pure I. Okay, so this is nothing but volume of I at temperature T and pressure P, okay, divided by number of moles of I. So this is the basic definition. So this is what is there in the ideal mixture. This doesn't change, but in a real mixture it changes. So the change is, this is the mixture and this is before mixing what the individual species had volumes. So this is the change in thing. So if I now try to expand this quantity, this capital V is nothing but summation of Ni, sorry. Ni Ei bar, which is the partial molar property, minus summation of Ni Vi bar, which is nothing but summation over Ni into Vi bar minus Vi bar. Now this is the partial molar specific or partial molar volume of species I as in the mixture, and this is the molar specific volume of I in the mixture. Both of them have the same units because this is also defined as del V by del Ni at constant Nj not equal to I Tnp. Okay, this is your V bar of I. So this is also volume per mole. So this is also meter cube per kilomole. And this is also meter cube per kilomole. So they have the same unit. Only thing is the difference is that this is the substance, pure substance I, and this is the same substance I when it exists in the mixture because it has changed properties because of mixing. This is this. So this is the change in volume due to mixing. In the same fashion, you can also define internal energy, enthalpy, entropy due to the mixing changes. So you will get delta V mix is equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n of Ni into Vi minus Vi bar. Or if I want to write it in terms of specific volume, just divide throughout by n, then I will get delta V mix, okay, is equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n of Xi into Vi bar minus Vi bar. Okay, so this is your change in volumes, change in specific volume due to mixing. Similarly, delta U due to mixing is equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n of Ni into Ui bar, which is in the mixture, minus Ui bar, which is the property molar specific internal energy. So this is molar specific internal energy of pure I at temperature T, pressure P, or pressure Pi rather, right? And this one is the partial molar sometimes written as molar, both are correct, partial molar internal energy or internal energy of species I as it exists in the mixture at T P Xi I is equal to 1 to n. So the state is now going to include the composition, temperature, pressure and composition. So this is the delta U mix, and similarly you can write delta U mix is equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n of Xi into Ui bar minus Ui bar. So be very careful about writing in capital and small letters, because the entire distinction is between capital and small letters. The small letter Ui refers to the molar specific property of pure substance, and capital letter Ui is the specific partial molar property for species I when it is in the mixture. In the same way, we can write for entropy and enthalpy also. The enthalpy of mixing, delta H mix, is equal to, so your mixing process can be exothermic or endothermic depending on the enthalpy of the mixture minus the enthalpy of the pure substance. This is So there are some substances which liberate heat on mixing, there are some substances which absorb heat on mixing. So this is summation for I is equal to 1 to n of ni into hi bar minus hi bar and delta S mix is equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n of ni into si bar minus si bar. Okay. So, and correspondingly you will get the quantities here, delta H mix per mole per unit, this is delta H per mix, so this is per mole of the mixture, this will be equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n of xi into hi bar minus hi bar, and delta S mix is equal to summation of I is equal to 1 to n of xi into si bar minus si bar. Okay, so this is the change in properties due to convection. So when I mix substances, the change in volume that happens is this volume of the mixture minus volume of the pure substance that constitutes the mixture. So that is what you actually get in this. Now, if I write the mathematical expression for let us say the internal energy of mixture, for pure substances we know that du is equal to Tds minus Tdv. Okay, for a simple compressible substance we know that Tds is equal to du plus Pdv. This is something that we have written. So basically you could derive this general equation from assuming a reversible heat transfer, so dq is Tds and reversible work transfer Pdv. So the change in internal energy is equal to delta Qn plus delta W on, so you get this expression. This is for a pure substance. So in this you basically wrote that U is equal to U of S comma V, and therefore du is del U by del S at constant V ds plus del U by del V at constant S dv, and you compared these two and said that this is T and this is minus P. Okay, so this is something that you remember. Now in a mixture, I know that U is going to be a function of S and V, of course, but it is also going to be a function of N1, N2, Nn, and therefore if I want to write this expression du, that du will be equal to del U by del S at constant V and N, and I is equal to 1 to N. Okay, this into ds plus similarly del U by del V at constant S and N and dv, plus likewise we can say del U by del N1 at constant S V N J not equal to I dni d. Okay, so this I'll write this, this a summation over this. I'll make some space there. Okay, so this is plus the summation over I is equal to 1 to n, because I'll be able to differentiate this to n1, n2, n3, n4, so I'll get a del u by del n1 dn1, del u by del n2 dn2, and so on. So it is summed over all of these quantities now. So this is your expression that you would get. And by comparing with the original expression, I'll be able to still say that del u by del s at constant V and constant composition can still be called the temperature T, and del u by del V at constant S and composition can still be called minus P. So if I write this, this can be T dS minus P dV, and what I will call this, the third quantity, del u by del ni, when S and V are kept constant, all the other species are kept constant, this I will call it as, let us say, mu I. So then I will get a summation of I is equal to 1 to n of mu I into dn. Okay, so now du becomes tds minus pdv plus summation of n mu I dn. Now if I use this expression, I know du is equal to tds minus pdv plus summation of I is equal to n of mu I dni. Okay, now I know h is equal to u plus pv. Okay, so dh will be equal to du plus pdv plus vdp. So if I look at du plus pdv, it will be actually tds plus this. So I get is equal to vdp plus tds plus summation of I is equal to 1 to n of ui dni. Right? Because du plus pdv, I substitute du plus pdv is equal to tds plus summation of this. So I will get vdp plus tds plus summation of this. So this is an expression. So from this I will be able to say h is equal to h of p, s and ni. This should be small n, not capital N. Okay, here also. Okay, so this is another expression. Ni equal to 1 to n. So this is you get. So you can actually say then V is del H by del P at constant S and N, and T is del H by del S at constant P and N. That is something we can write. Likewise, you can write G, the Gibbs function, is equal to H minus TS, which will be DH, so DG DG will actually then be equal to DH minus TDS minus SDT, and here I can write DH minus TDS is VDP plus this, so this will be VDP minus SDT plus summation of I is equal to 1 to n of mu I dni. Okay, and similarly I write A, which is the Helmholtz function, which is equal to u minus ts, and therefore dA is equal to du minus tds minus SDT, and from here I will say du minus tds is minus pdv plus this, so I will be able to write this as minus pdv minus SDT plus summation or I is equal to 1 to n of mu I dni. Now from this there are a few things that we will need to observe. One is that in this expression, if you recall, for pure substances we derived it from the modes of interaction. So this is the interaction by contact, and this was the compression work, and now there is a whole set of works that have got added, which basically are expressed in the form of some the generalized force multiplied by some change in generalized coordinate. This we call it as the chemical work, and this quantity mu I is known as the chemical potential. Of species I as it exists in the mixture, at in this particular case TP, all right, and I equal to 1 to n as it exists. In this particular case, it will be S and V instead of T and P, S, V and S, right? So this is the thing that you get. So this mu I is known as the chemical potential, and DNI is the change in the chemical number of moles of species I. So product of mu I DNI is the chemical work that is introduced by the change in composition of species I. Likewise, you have a chemical work for the change in composition of every other species adding up, and that will give you the total thing. So this, all of this is the generalized work. This is the compression work, and this is the chemical work for each species, and this is the interaction by contact. So that is how you interpret this. So you get a generalized force and generalized coordinate composition pair for chemical work as well, just like you had VE, DQE for electrical work, or sigma DA for surface tension work, you have mu I DNI for the chemical work. So this is one expression that you get, and you define a quantity called chemical potential. And how do you define the quantity called chemical potential? If I come here, then I'll be able to write this as del G by del P at constant Tn dp plus del G by del T at constant Pn into dp into dt plus summation of del G by del Ni at constant Tpn j not equal to I into dNi. Okay. So now this T, P, N, J not equal to I form, I is equal to 1 to N, basically defines a partial molar property. So you can identify this as the partial molar Gibbs function of species I, which is the same as the chemical potential. So the chemical potential of any substance is actually defined as the partial molar Gibbs function, simply because this is the only definition in which the temperature and pressure come. And when temperature pressure are kept constant and only the species I is varied, keeping all the other species constant, the change in Gibbs function gives you the mu I. So this mu I is equal to del G by del Ni at constant Tp and J not equal to I. Actually, the mu I is going to be equal to multiple things. This is going to be equal to del, in this particular case, it will be del U by del Ni. Okay, at constant S, V, N, J not equal to I. That is also equal to the second case, del H by del Ni at constant S, comma P, comma, and J not equal to I. It's also equal to del G by del Ni at constant T, P, and J not equal to I. And in the last one, it gives you del A by del Ni at constant T, V, and J not equal to I. Okay, so this chemical potential is actually all of these, and only this actually, because it is temperature, pressure, and J not equal to I, is a partial molar property. All the others don't qualify to be partial molar property. So it actually is partial molar Gibbs function. So the chemical potential of species is defined as a partial molar Gibbs function, and it acts as the generalized force for the chemical interaction that happens here. So depending on the value of mu I as it exists in the mixture at these properties multiplied by the change in ni, you get the chemical work that is done on this. So in other words, if I have to mix, then there is a certain chemical work, and if I have to unmix, then the opposite quantity of that work has to be done. So if you need to, if you mix two substances and there is energy output, it gives out energy, then you need to put in the same amount of energy in order to be able to separate them out. So that is the thing that you need. So if I want to, for example, estimate the amount of work required or the energy input required in order to, for example, desalinate seawater. So you take seawater and remove salt from it to make pure water. Then what is the amount of effort involved can be calculated using the chemical potential of the salt as it exists in the pure water, and the change that needs to be done integrated over the value of salt concentration as it exists in the sea to the value of salt concentration that is tolerable for drinking water. So in that limit, if you integrate the mu I dmi, then you get the amount of effort that needs to be put in order to desalinate the water. So that is the interpretation that you get. So we'll at this moment stop here, and we have understood the concepts. We still don't know how to evaluate the chemical potential or these things, but in today's class we clearly understood a few things. One is that the mixing process is not ideal as we studied in the previous classes. There may be special cases where the changes are negligible, but in general there is always a change in extensive properties whenever there is a mixing that happens. And the change in mixing, a change in extensive properties due to mixing is quantified as the summation over the partial molar property minus the pure substance property at the same temperature and pressure multiplied by the mole fraction of the individuals summed up over the number of species. Right? So that's something we found. And then from the basic chemical thermodynamic relationships, we were able to define a quantity called chemical potential, which works out to be the partial molar Gibbs function. And that also works out to be the generalized force for chemical work. So chemical work is defined as the chemical potential multiplied by change in the number of moles of a particular species. And that summed over all the species gives the total chemical work to be done in order to change the composition from one state to another, or the chemical work that is done on the object when the changes, the change of state from pure substance to mixture happens. Right. So this is basically what we have understood. We'll stop here and continue in the next lecture on what are the ways in which these can be quantified. How can you quantify the chemical potential? How do you define the properties of a mixture starting from the chemical potential, and so on. We'll look at it from the next class onwards. We'll stop here for this class.